this was a part of my childhood. You know, it was like, this is what we had, La Pompa. I grew up in the South Bronx.
Where at?
Southern Boulevard. My parents are from Puerto Rico. You know, I love my culture and going back to Puerto Rico, and that's why I love Spanish Harlem, because it brings me back.
I noticed you shoot a lot of images of people. What about people inspire you? I mean, what draws you to shoot? And most of them, I imagine, are strangers.
I don't know. It's strange because, yeah, most of them are strangers. The people are what, you know, it's what makes the neighborhood. It's what, you know, it's the core of the whole. So this photo, it was for the 116th Street Feast, and I was just walking in the streets and I saw the kids playing, and I was like, oh my god, I gotta get these shots. And this was actually like the last role that I had, you know, which was a black and white film. And originally I wanted to shoot it in color, but this was the last role, and I was like, oh well, I guess I have to do black and white. And I got this shot.
It's a beautiful shot. Do you shoot in film or digital?
Now digital.
Now in digital, all digital.
Yeah.
And do you continue to print?
Yes. It's hard for me because I don't have that much time, but if I, you know, I love to print.
Is this your full-time work?
I have been a photographer for about 8.5 years, 9 years. But I have been photographing since I was about 12. When I first picked up my brother's camera, and I didn't want to let it go. I just loved it. I don't know what it is. You know, it was just like, I'm still like that obsessive about it.
En mi vida. Y yo le digo a las personas que hacen fotografía, de serio lo que te haciendo. O si no es la primera cosa que tú piensas por la mañana, y la última cosa que tú piensas cuando te vas a dormir, no es para ti. O si te vas a imaginar que te va a hacer millones de dinero, no es para ti. Porque eso es mucha suerte, pero también mucho talento. Pero talento es la mitad, la suerte es la otra mitad. Y es fuerte. Pero eso es lo único que yo quiero hacer. Y como el otro trabajo es que yo soy Program Director de un non-profit. And lo hice en inglés, we help to promote photographers of color. Y yo estoy ahí por 7 años haciendo exhibiciones para otros fotógrafos y haciendo publicaciones para ellos. I travel to Puerto Rico often, as much as I can, once a year or once every other year. It's a place where my parents are from and a place where I consider myself being from, even though I was born in the Bronx. I don't consider myself a New York Rican.
You don't?
I don't. I was born in New York. I was raised as a Puerto Rican. Although I understand that there are filters involved being here. My first language was Spanish, even though I speak it very horrendous right now. My heart is in Puerto Rico. There's a romanticism involved in the whole idea of the island, la isla, volver otra vez. And I would definitely want a home over there eventually, hopefully sooner than later. So in understanding that and understanding the reason why Puerto Rico is kind of, it belongs to the United States, and I wanted to understand it even further and visit my family and visit someone of Taino heritage, which is what that project and that vacation or discovery was about. So I contacted some Tainos in the Bronx, and they let me to a Taina in Puerto Rico, in Orocovis, Puerto Rico. So it was a long trip from where my family is at in Las Penas, Puerto Rico. But once I got up to the mountain, I met this Taina, and I wasn't sure what that meant, meeting someone who's Taino in Puerto Rico. I wasn't sure what vision that I would have. And when I get there, this is a regular person who has a belief in Taino culture, who is Taina in her DNA, her core. But she's also someone who went to university in the United States, who has a good job. She's a lawyer. She's married to a lawyer. But she kept her roots. She kept her raíces. She knows who she is. She follows the traditions of being a Taino in a modern world. So some of these images here, they're just a few images from a large body of work. The bate, which is an area which Tainos did rituals at. And this is in front of her home.
And this is in Orocovis, you said?
This is Orocovis, Puerto Rico. It's one of the highest points in Puerto Rico. One of the highest points. and then you see Naniki and someone else, and she's working her fields. Now, she has 400 acres of land. She owns the mountain practically. But she invites people over. She opened her home to me and my sister to go visit. The water that came from our faucets comes from the spring on that mountain. So it's a lot about land and nature and feeling. Bito's actually, it was the same trip, but Bito is from Ponce, and what I found during that trip is how humilde, how wonderful these people were. Everywhere I went, they didn't know me or my sister. They were just very kind and very loving, every part of Puerto Rico, and that's been my experience since I've been traveling there as a kid. And I also lived there when I was 3 years old, so it's not foreign. It inspires me as a human being, and that's just the first step of being inspired as a photographer.
You grew up in the Bronx?
Yes, I
did. Where in the Bronx did you grow up?
Actually, this question would lead us to the Fireman Project. The time when I lived on 1105 Jerome Avenue. It was 1977. My dad had just bought his Nova, golden Nova. I remember it being parked in front of a building not far from Yankee Stadium. So, you know, when you're a kid, you have all these visions. The colors look richer, everything's bigger, everything's nicer. And for us, Disney World was Great Adventures, because Fonny went to Great Adventures and we had a blast. Everything was terrific. We left when the park closed. I probably fell asleep on the car over. My dad puts us to bed, us meaning my older brother, my sister, and myself. Sometime around 2 or 3 a.m. in the morning, my mom is waking me up. She's waking me up because there's a cloud of smoke all around the apartment, all around us. I can barely see her, and all I smell is smoke. So she's trying to get me dressed. She can't. My dad grabs me. We run down the steps. We're on the 7th floor, the top floor of the building. We get downstairs. He puts us in the car, and all I can see are the fire trucks and the sirens and the lights and the people in front of the building. Now, what happened at that time is that the landlords weren't getting their rent paid, so they were losing money. So, and they're genius, they figured out a way how to get paid, and that was to get an arsonist, pay him off, get insurance money. Without a care to the people that were living in those buildings and what would happen to them. Soon after, we were able to stay in the building and move in another apartment, losing most of our items. Again, an arsonist came by to visit. I can't remember the second fire, but I know that our family was split apart. We were living in different places, different family members, didn't even have our own clothing. Eventually, we moved to Castle Hill Avenue, which is the place where I still reside. So the Fireman Project, you know, it doesn't just come out of thin air. You have things that happen to you in your life, experiences that lead you to different projects, different ideas, and different beliefs.